Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Zara Chapiwala from Virasat-e-Hind Foundation. Today, under the paper of Art and Architecture of India, we are going to talk about the Kalinga School of Temple Architecture, which was prevalent in the Kalinga region, that is the present-day Odisha and parts of Bihar and Bengal. Under this paper, we are planning to talk about origin and development of the Kalinga School of Architecture. The three types of temples that are prevalent there, of course, their features and evolution, and also what are the famous prominent temples of the region. Odisha, or the present-day Odisha, or the ancient Kalinga, was situated on the eastern seaboard of India and has been a major center of Hindu religious architecture from 7th century CE. Bhubaneswar, the capital of Odisha, literally means Bhuban, abode of Ishwar, God, here Shiva. There is also this region is also known as the Ekamrakshetra. Why? Because Shiva, which is the predominant deity that is worshipped in the region, his linga was found under a mango tree. A single mango tree, Ek Amra. So that is how the name comes, Ek Amra Kshetra. In fact, it's very interesting to note that the name Bhubaneswar could also be coming from his consort, which in the Kalinga temples is Bhuneshwari. Now, this city was at the heart of building activity. At one point of time, there were thousands of temples, though today only a few remain extant. The temples of Bhubaneswar display exquisite craftsmanship and artisanship in sculpture, carvings, ornamentation, architecture. It is very interesting to note also here that the outer walls of the Kalinga temples are sculpted heavily. But the inner walls remain plain. There are very few temples that have, you know, sculptures. Even if they do exist, they are very few. It is the outer walls that are embellished very beautifully. We will talk about that a little more later. So, Ekamrakshetra sprawls over 10 miles with the Lingaraj temple and the Bindusagar lake as its center, the nerve center basically, from where it spreads. According to Ekamra Purana, 7,000 temples existed in the vicinity of just Bindusagar, just that one lake. Today, out of those thousands, only a few remain extant. And from 12th century CE, the focus of temple building shifted from Bhubaneswar, which was the nerve center, to Puri and Konark. We will even be talking about how this system came into decline a little later. This is how Kalinga Desa looked like. Today it is the district of Bhubaneswar. Kalinga Desa, which was there earlier, was the belt between the two rivers, Mahanadi and Godavari. As you can see in the map. In 3rd century BCE, Kalinga was annexed by the Emperor Ashoka after the Kalinga War, and that is how the name came. It was subsequently ruled by several dynasties, including the Mahamegavahana, Sailadbhava, Bhaumakaras, Somavanshis, Eastern Gangas, and the Gajapatis. Between the periods of 11th and 15th century CE, Kalinga was ruled by the Eastern Gangas, who also bore the title of Kalinga Adipati, and that is how they called themselves, the Adipatis or the rulers, and that is why the title Kalinga Adipati. Some of Odisha's greatest temples, such as the Jagannath temple at Puri and the Sam temple at Konark, were built by the Eastern Gangas. Their capital was originally located at Kalinganagar, which is Mukhalingam in present day Andhra Pradesh, and it was later shifted to Cuttack, which is the present-day Cuttack, in 12th century CE. Now, the temples of Odisha follow a local style of Nagara, or the North Indian School of Temple Architecture. Basically, the temple architecture in our country have been divided into the North, South and the hybrid, that is the Nagara, Dravida and the Vaisara style of temple architectures. Broadly, the Kalinga school of architecture comes under the Nagara style of temple because of its shikhara, curvilinear shikhara. But of course, there are points which also display some of the features of the Dravida school of architecture as well. So they're quite different, very distinct from the other temples, and that is why they have a separate, they are considered a separate genre altogether. The temples of Kalinga order followed a common structural and elevation plan. In the Kalinga school of temple architecture, all the temples had this particular hierarchy of command of how they were built. There was the karta, the patron or the king who wanted to build the temple or who would finance the temple. The temple was predominantly built or planned by the mukhya sthapati or the chief builder. And then there was the sutra grahani, the chief engineer. In most of the cases, this chief engineer, sutra grahani, was the son of the mukhya sthapati or the chief builder. Once they would select the site of where the temple has to build, even that involved a lot of knowledge of silpa shastras, vastu shastras and other such sutras which talked about geology, geography, magnetism, and they were, then they would place a point where the garbhagriha or the sanctum sanctorum would be built, and from there would be an axis running vertically. That is the point from where they would start building. Then would come the bardhanikas or the masons who would start dressing stones and build it. And then would come the kastakas or the sculptors who would sculpt what was built. This was the process used. And most of the materials used were mostly chlorite or laterite, mostly. Chlorite, laterite, and a little later there were also temples that used clay bricks. There were only few of the temples who used the clay bricks, but mostly it was chlorite. Then because of its long lasting nature and also that it is easy to sculpt. Now the superstructure of a temple, Kalinga temple would be basically divided into three parts, the bada, the gandhi and the mastaka, that is the lower limb, the body and the head. Actually, all the temples in the school of architecture have taken their names from parts of the human body. Even the structure is like that. So you have the lower middle and upper torso. We are talking about that. So we will go through the structure in detail, which is the bada is the vertical section of pilasters from the pitha, that is the plinth, up to the base of the kalasha, that is the shikhara from the top. This, the first thing that is built in the in these order of temples is the pota and the pitha. The pota is the foundation and the pitha is the plinth that is visible on top. The enclosure created by this bada is the garbhagriha or the sanctum sanctorum. The different vertical sections of the bada from the bottom are the pabhaga or the pada, sacred foot, the talajhanga, lower leg, bandhani, the knee, uparajanga, upper leg, and barandi, waistline. As I've already said before, we take names from the human body. So gandhi is the body segment of the temple above the bada, wherein the rekhas or the pagas are prominent. These rathakas or pagas are the curvy linear pilasters like structures rising above the bada level, and they gradually curve inward and form a horizontal surface called the ghoda chakkada. It is named the ghoda chakkada because chakkada means a slab of stone and ghoda means a cover. Basically, it's an Odia name for the pilasters. In improvised temples, towards the lower middle portion of the Gandhi, Bajra Mastaka motifs are seen. This Bajra Mastaka motifs are nothing but a Chaityagriha with a Kirtimukha on top, which is also known as Bhogirtimukha. The Bhogirtimukha. The Bhogirtimukha is where you have the mythical and the real worlds coming together because you have a fantastic, a mythical creature there. Okay, in tall temples, more than one Ghoda Chakkada are used, which means that there are many levels or closed chambers created. As per the rituals, various things were kept in these chambers. For aeration, small openings through Udayata Singhas are kept. Now, Udayata Singhas are prominently visible on the shikharas of Kalinga's temples. They are nothing but a slab of stone with a lion on top. The Udayata Singha, lion. The lion is mostly below. There is an elephant. Sometimes the elephant might not be there. And there is only a slab of stone. But what they indicate is that there is an opening of a chamber in which a few ceremonial things are kept. And they are always above the level of the Ghoda Chakkada, the Udayata Singhas. So this basically is also a variation of the Gajasimha Vidala or the Vyala. The Vyala or the Vyali, that is the most commonly seen on the walls of Odishan temples or the Kalinga order, are the Gaja Simha Vyala. Gaja, elephant, Simha, the lion. The mastaka of the temple, this is how it looks. The mastaka of the temple is divided into six parts. The neck or the beki, the three patta dhara, the three thin lines on the upper portion of beki just under the amalaka. You have to note, these are very big. You might think these are small, but these are very big. The scale is very high. So if you notice in the temples, you can easily find this three thin lines on the upper portion of beki just under the amalaka shila. In the Kalingan order of the temples, the amalakas or the rib stone on top, the gooseberry structure, rib stone, that is known as Amalaka otherwise, is known as the Amalaka Shila. The Amalaka Shila. Then there is a Kapuri, that is the cap-like structure on top of the Amalaka Shila. Then there is the Kalasha, the sacred pot. And the sacred pot here is not just another pot. It also has various parts, which are pada, dori, handi, patti, beki, khapuri, and gaddi. And because these are eight parts, that is why it is known as the Ashtanga Kalasha. The ayuda, or the sacred weapon. Almost every temple of the Kalingan order, you will find a weapon on top, right on top of the Amalaka Shila, which is either a trident representing Shiva, or sometimes it could be a spear or a bow and an arrow with a flag. There will always be a flag there. So the main portions of the Kalingan order of temples are the Sanctum Sanctorum, and because that has the Sanctum Sanctorum, it is called Deul, the shrine. Deul is the Odia word for shrine. So the main part is known as Deul, or the apartment that enshrines the deity and is surmounted by a tall tower which we call the Shikhara, the curvy linear Shikhara. In front of this is the porch called the Jagmohana, which is usually square shape and has a stacked pyramidal roof, like the Vimanas. This Jagmohana was how the Kalingan temples started, with just one Jagmohana and one Deul, that is the Rekha Deul temples, mostly exhibit these features. Later on, as the temples started evolving and as the rituals also with them started evolving, there were two more structures added in front, which is the Natya Mandapa or the dance hall, the Bhoga Mandapa, which was meant for feasting, hall of offerings. It is very interesting here to note that the development of Natya Mandapa is the development of the Odissi dance, because it also is related to the Devadasi system that was prevalent at that time, when girls were selected to be married off to the Lord and then remain in their service singing and dancing for them. So though the Devadasi system in other parts of the country was quite abused, in Odisha, the Devadasis were given a lot of respect. And even today, some of them do exist, though now they are not that important. But in few of the temples, especially in the Konark and the Puri temples, there were a particular rituals that only the Devadasis would perform. In fact, they were the only women who were allowed in the Sanctum Sanctorum. This shows how much respect they gave them. They were not considered the way other Devadasis were considered in the other parts of the country. Okay, now coming back to our Deuls, these were extensively carved, had chambers, projected balconies, and the temples of Bhubaneswar have dark, compact interiors devoid of pillars. The most important feature of the Kalingan order of temple is it is devoid of pillars. The roof was supported mostly by iron girders. There were no pillars. You will not find pillars in their mandaps. The mandaps are devoid of pillars. Now the Kalingan temples are divided basically into three distinct types. The first type is the Rekha Deol, those with a curvilinear roof above the Sanctum Sanctorum resembling a peak. The Pida Deol, the stacked pyramidal roof over an assembly hall. Now Pida Deols are like the Jagmohan, the Bhog Mandap, or the Natya Mandap you have. The main point to note here is a Pida Deol does not have a Sanctum Sanctorum. It can be a standalone, separated from the main temple, but it is not a shrine. It is not a shrine with a Sanctum Sanctorum. It is always a hall meant for certain rituals. Then the third type is the Khakhra Deol, the barrel vaulted roof with an inner sanctum. The Khakhra, the name comes from pumpkin, Khakru, the pumpkin, because of the shape. It looks like a pumpkin that is cut down. The barrel vaulted roof looks like a pumpkin that is cut. Most of the Khakhra Deol temples are Shakti temples. That is, they are all dedicated to feminine deities. Rekha. We'll talk about all these in details. So the Rekha Deol. Rekha in Odia means a straight line. The typical Rekha Deol complex has a shrine with different parts of the temples which align on the same line or the axis. Earlier in the lecture, I had already spoken about how a point is noted down. There an 8-petaled lotus is placed before they place the deity. The deity is placed there, but before that they place that. That is the, the eight petal lotus, which talks about the eight directions. And from that point rises up the axis or the rekha, which from where you align all the structures. And that is why all the Kalingan order temples are geometrically or symmetrically just perfect. And this are the various types of rekhadil shikharas. As you can see, they curve inwards. They are mostly straight, but just before the amalaka or the edge of the shikhara, they curve inside and they look like a mountain, and that is why it is known as the shikhar of the temple. These temples or the rekhadyul may have a singular deity and just be a complete small temple, just one deity. Or so there would also, just as the school evolved or just as the architecture evolved, there are also rekhadyuls that might have multiple deities and a floor plan, which is a panchayatan plan. And these temples are typically dedicated to Vishnu, Surya and Shiva. Odisha in its initial stages was a place where the Shaiva cult or the Pashupata cult was very prominent. That is why you will find most of the temples dedicated to Shiva. It was only later when the Eastern Gangas came to rule, and later the Gajapatis, they were Vaishnavites. And that is why you will find few temples where the elements were introduced, Vaishnavite elements are introduced, and that is why you will also find deities like the Harihara, that is the Hari is Vishnu and Hara being Shiva. The most distinct examples of Rekhadyul type of temple are the Jagannath temple at the Puri and the Lingaraj temple in Bhuvaneshwar. The Pidadyul refers to the square building with a pyramidal shaped roof consisting of pidas. Pidas are the horizontal platforms. If you notice here in the picture, the pyramidal shaped roof that you can see here have pidas. They have platform. It looks like, you know, there are platforms just stacked one on top of the other. So that is why they are called as Pidadyul. The Pidas are the horizontal platforms and they are arranged in three tiers. There are three distinct tiers here, if you notice. They were much simpler when they began and they kept on getting more ornamental and complicated as the school and its features evolved. Typically, these structures are seen as supportive structures to a Rekhadyul with a assembly hall or the Jagmohan, and often later the Natyamandir and the Bhogmandap are also built in this style. So the assembly halls or the dance hall or the congregation hall, whichever, all the halls were built in this style known as the Pidadyul. This structure is seen in mostly all of the temples barring the Khakradyuls. The assembly hall of the Konark Sun temple is the most outstanding example of a Pidadyul, the Khakradyul. So this is a completely different style of structure. If you look at, especially if you look at Rekhadyul or the Pidadyul, you will find this to be very different. And it is almost similar to the Dravidian Gopuram style. That is because it has a barrel vaulted roof, which is very common in the Dravida school of temple architecture, famous down south. The word derived, Khakru is derived from pumpkin god, as the crown looks like one. It is a rectangular shaped building with a truncated pyramidal shaped roof. If you look at the roof, it will look like someone tried to build a pyramid but cut it on the top, giving it that distinct shape. These temple complexes generally have a Khakra Deol and a Pida Deol, but no Rekha Deols, in the sense that the sanctum sanctorum here is in the Khakra Deol, not the Rekha Deol. But you can have a Pida Deol, that is, you know, the assembly hall, the congregation hall, the Bhog Mandap, that is the hall of offering, and of course the Natya Mandap, the hall of dance. They might be there, but no Rekha Deol, because the sanctum sanctorum here is in the Khakra Deol. The temples of the feminine deities, Shakti, are of the Khakra style, as we have already discussed this earlier. The Varahi temple at Chaurasi and the Vetal Deola at Bhuneshwar are the most prominent examples of this Khakra order. The temples of Odisha portray a picture of organic evolution from the Parshurameshwara to Lingaraj in Bhubaneswar, eventually culminating in Puri and Konark. Let's go through these phases of evolution and also the prominent temples. The formative phase, that is 6th to 9th century CE, transitional phase, mature phase, and the decline phase. Through various centuries, we will talk more about what came about in these phases. So the first phase is from the 6th to 9th centuries CE, where the dominant dynasty were the Bhaumakaras. The Bhaumakaras were Shaivas. And the finest example of their style of architecture was the Vetal Deola. In this phase, the Rekha Deol is seen mostly. All the temples are seen, as you can see here in the picture as well. You have a Rekha Deol and you have the Pida Deol. And as you can see, the Jagmohan or the Pida Deol, the Pidas are just a single. There is just a single horizontal platform. They are not stacked. They are simple. They are not stacked. So the Jagmohan, as usual, does not have pillars and does not have a stacked roof. They are very simple. If you even notice the Rekha Deol, it is more simpler in the sense that it does not have too many sculptures on its outer walls. The dominant dynasty during the transitional phase, which was from 9th to 11th century, were the Somvanshis. And the finest temples they built are the Mukteshwar temple, the Rajarani temple, the Lingaraj temple in Bhuvaneshwar. The Mukteshwar temple is known for its Torana, which is not seen otherwise in other temples. We will go through the main points of transitional phase. The Pida Deol was developed and surmounted with a stacked conical roof. Now if you see here, from the earlier phase to now the transitional phase, now you can see the Pidas. You can see the horizontal slabs stacked one on top of the other in three. If you notice, there are no tires. There are not three tires. They are just stacked on top of other, one on top of the other. Earlier, it was not an inseparable part of a Kalingan order temple. But from 9th century CE, it became an inseparable part of an Odishan temple, the Pida Deols, that is the halls. And we also, what we need to notice are the ornamentations that came. The Rathakas, the Agnishikharas were introduced on the Gandhi, that is the style of the Shikhar. And the Rathakas are the chariots. The Udayata Singhas embellished the Mastaka along with the Amalaka Shila that we have already spoken about earlier, the Amalaka Shila with the Ashtanga Kalasha, the Khapuri, the Ayuda, and the Dwaja. So this was not seen earlier, these as separate parts of Rekha Dwij. In the mature phase, that is after the development of these various parts, we find in the mature phase, which was from 11th to 13th century CE, that all these parts were developed completely. You have the Natya Mandap now, the Bhoga Mandap, and the Pistha or the Pitha plinth was more visible because it was built on a raised height. The platforms were raised. The finest example being the Konark Sun Temple and the Jagannath Temple at Puri. One of them is a World Heritage Site. In the mature phase, the Natya Mandap and the Bhog Mandap were added in front of the Pitha Dwij, each structure ascending in height to the previous one. If you notice in the pictures also, you will see how it goes one on top of the other. So you have first the Rekha Dwij, the Jagmohan, then you have the Natya Mandap and the Bhog Mandap. So there was a distinct development of the design in the Saptaratha pattern. Instead of having just one main deity in the Sanctum Sanctorum, there were three or more Sanctum Sanctorums with multiple deities. The provisions were made for porches and subsidiary temples for accommodating the Parasvadevtas or the aligning deities. One of the most dominant features of the Jagmohan were the six sadhana motifs, or the guru imparting instructions, or related motifs of a royal figure surrounded by courtiers or riding in a procession. The sculptures seen on the Kalingan temples, we will be talking about them in more details a bit later, were very different and very distinct, and they had their own significance. We will be talking about them. This became a standard decoration of the Gava Samadana panel on the transept, a placement prescribed in the Silpa Prakash. Like you had the Silpa Shastra, there were other treaties as well, one of them being the Silpa Prakash. According to Silpa Prakash, this was a standard decoration, these six sadhana motifs. From this was developed the concept of the Mukti Mandap during the 15th centuries. During the decline phase, that is when this school of temple architecture began to decline, the dominant dynasty during this period were the Gajapatis. The sculptural art of the Kalingan temples may broadly be classified into, that is the sculptures that you will notice on the temples or the panels, the deities, the celestial figures or apsaras, the musicians, nymphs, secular sculptures, architectural motifs, decorative patterns like the floral, geometric motifs, etc. Among the female divinities that adorn the temple walls of Odisha, the most noteworthy depictions are those of Salabanjikas, the woman embracing the tree. As you can see here, this is a very common motif on all temples of the Kalingan order, because the woman here embracing a tree, generally a sal tree, though not necessary, but the name comes from there, Salabanjika, or the Yakshini who is embracing a tree, is a fertility rite, because the tree denotes abundance. Fertility is seen in the flowering trees, the voluptuous forms of the women, and also sometimes in the child accompanying the woman. Salabanjikas are also yakshinis, forest dryads, fertilizing deities who have the power to bring trees to flower by the mere touch of the foot. That is why they are the forest nymphs. They were manifestations of Shakti, Lord Shiva's female principle. After he divided himself into the male and the female parts, Shakta and Shakti, the male further split into 11 Rudras, while the female divided itself into a multitude of Shaktis, the Yoginis, the Yakshinis. Hirapur, a village on the outskirts of Bhubaneswar, has preserved a beautiful Yogini temple where Shakti is manifested in its 64 forms. In fact, with the Kalingan order being very distinct, there is also another form of temple architecture, which is the hypatral style, that is circular temples which are roofless. These temples, all dedicated to the Yogini, called the Yogini temples, are presently there at only 5 to 7 places in entire country. And these type of temples are exactly what inspired the design of our Parliament House. The Parliament House that is present in Delhi today is inspired from these Yogini temples, and one of the most well-preserved and the most beautifulest of Yogini temple is in Hirapur, which is in Odisha. Through their glamour and power, these goddesses pull the devotees to their central divinity. They are also beautiful Alasakanyas, the indolent damsels, wanting their voluptuous beauties in seductive poses. Musicians, dancers, and figures of love, both sublime and sensual, in great moving forms. You will find these Alasakanyas, that is, they are just there enjoying their time and being there on the walls of the temples. They are the most predominantly seen nymphs, apart from the Salabanjikas, the Alasakanyas. The Nagas and the Naginis are the other group of deities, the serpent deities, that can be seen on the vaults of Kalingan order temples. The Nagas and the Naginis coexist with Yakshinis on the temple walls. Otherwise, they are supposed to be living in the Patal Loka. The serpent deities are associated with the Patal Loka, or the subterranean realm, and are guardians of earth's treasures. They reside in Patal Loka. Patal Loka is supposed to be a splendid city, more grander than heaven that is built by Indra. Nagas and Naginis boast of many niches visible in their heavy necklaces, armbands, crowns, and jewel offerings that they hold in their hands. So they are riches. These are the riches of the earth. What they represent are the riches that the earth has in its wombs, that is the gemstones, gold, silver, and other types of precious and semi-precious metals and stones. On the walls of the temples, the Nagas take on a worshipful role, offering both garlands as well as jewels. If you notice here in the sculpture, most of them are holding a garland. The Naga or the Nagini, they are holding a garland. The garland and whatever the jewels that are there are mostly for offering to the deity. Some of the Odishan temples display musicians and dancers on their exterior walls. Most, even other temples, if you notice in our country, definitely have these sculptures, and they are not new or distinct to the Kalingan order, but what is to be noted is their form. They're quite slender and handsome in appearance, some holding lutes, drums. In fact, one can talk about the musical instruments that were prevalent during those centuries after looking at these sculptures. They tell of the dance forms and the music forms that were prevalent in those times. Odissi, the classical dance of Odisha, is one of the oldest in India. And its evolution can be traced in the temples of Bhubaneswar. You will find poses, you will find people indulging themselves in the dance, and you will find accompanied musicians as well. So, and the temples, the Kalingan order temples, were where these dance forms were practiced in its initial stages. Before they had schools, the Natya Mandap of the temple was exactly where the school of this dance was located. There were no separate Gurukulas. Several panels in Mukteshwar temple, Sari Deol, Lingaraj and Brahmeshwar temple show male and female ascetics preaching their disciples who stand in front of them with folded hands. They represent religious instructions. Odisha was under the grip of various cults for a very long period. The Vajrayana or the Tantric Buddhism and the Pashupata cult that was prevalent in those times. In fact, you can find the sculpture of La Kulisha on many of the Shaiva temples. La Kulisha was the one who began the Pashupata cult, in which Shiva was worshipped in his original form of Pashupati, Lord of the Animals. You will find Pashupati on the seals of Indus Valley civilization. That is how he was worshipped earlier, before we changed him into his inionic form of a linga. Later on, Adi Shankara, during the time of the Gajapatis, established a math in Puri, popularizing the cult of Sri Vidya. Sri Vidya cult worshipped the Trinity, that is Vishnu, Shiv and Brahma. Later, this was clubbed with Vaishnavism. So when it was clubbed with Vaishnavism, Shiva and Brahma took a back seat and Vishnu was prayed to more. That is, in Odisha, it is Lord Jagannath. The form of Vishnu in Odisha is Lord Jagannath. The Lord Jagannath took over, and even today, it is an intrinsic part of Odisha's cultural and religious life. Other sculptures that one can see on the temple walls are the erotic sculptures. These couples that indulge themselves in erotic activities are also known as mithunas. Okay, they mark their presence there. In fact, the erotic sculptures of the Rajarani temple in Bhuvaneshwar are considered as an inspiration to the Khajuraho group of temples. The Rajarani temple is called the Khajuraho of Odisha. Let's talk about the important temples of the Kalinga school of temple architecture. The Parshurameshwara temple is considered the best preserved specimen of Kalinga temple, dated to the Shalodbhava period, that is between the 7th and the 8th centuries CE. This is again a Shaiva temple. If you notice, since this is an earlier temple, it has a very plain pyramid, Jagmohan. It does not have the pidas on top. These are some of the sculptures that you will notice on the temple. The Parshurameshwara temple has a vimana, the sanctum, the bada, the curvilinear spire rising to a height of 12.27 meters. It is the first temple to have an additional structure called Jagmohan, compared to the earlier temples that only had the vimana. That is, the Rekha Deol was a standalone temple in itself. Though the temple is dedicated to Shiva, it contains sculpted images of Shakta deities, which are otherwise normally part of Shakta temples. This temple is the first in Bhuvaneshwar to contain the depiction of Saptamatrikas, that is the Chamunda, Varahi, Indrani, Vaishnavi, Kaumari, Shivani and Brahmi. Vetal Deol. This beautiful temple, built in the 8th century CE, is dedicated to goddess Chamunda. This is a Khakra Deol style of temple, locally known as Tini Mundia Mandira, Vaital Deul's striking semi-cylindrical roof above the main shrine is an excellent example of the Khakra Deul. Here in this pictures, if you notice, this temple has the sculpture of Lakulisha. He looks like the Buddha, but he is the Lakulisha, along with other sculptures denoting the Shakti. You also have depiction of Lakulisha denoting how strong the presence of the cult was during those times. The outer walls are encrusted with panels of Hindu deities, mostly Shiva, Parvati, hunting processions, capturing of wild elephants, occasional erotic couples, the Mithunas. The facade of the Deul above the left of the Jagmohan is dominated by two Chaitya windows, the lower one having a beautifully carved figure of Surya, the sun god, noted for its facial expressions, Usha and Pratyusha, shooting arrows on either side, with Aruna in front driving a chariot of 7 horses, Usha, Pratyusha being consorts of Surya and Aruna being his charioteer. The medallion in the upper Chaitya window houses a 10-armed Nataraja or the dancing Shiva. In front of the flat-roofed Jagmohan is a stone post with Lakulisha images. The presence of Buddhism also was very ancient. Many of the temples in this form of architecture depict the Chaitya windows. In fact, the Chaitya windows are an architectural ornamentation in many forms of temples, not just the Kalingan order, but they can be seen even in the Nagara style of temple architecture, where they evolved from being a window to an ornamentation. This is the Mukteshwara temple. The temple is an important monument to study the evolution of this school of temple architecture. Built in 950 CE, Mukteshwara marks the culmination of all the earlier developments. It has a decorative torana or an arched gateways. It consists of thick pillars that have a string of beads and other ornaments carved on with statues of various women in languorous repose, that is those Alasakanyas. The Alasakanyas are present on the arch torana, that is the entrance of this Mukteshwara temple. The temple has two structures, namely Rekha Deul or Vimana and a Jagmohan or the congregation hall, both of which are built on a raised platform, as you can see in the pictures. The temple is earliest to be built with a Pidas Deul. Here you can find the Pida Deul with a stacked roof. It is the only Odishan temple with rich carvings on its interior walls. If you remember, very early in the lecture, I had elaborated on the point that the Kalingan order temples have richly carved exterior walls, but they have very plain interiors. So the Mukteshwara temple stands as a different temple in that way, that it has carvings also on its interior walls. One of the basic reasons why Mukteshwara temple is also known as the gem of Kalinga architecture. It is very beautiful, as you can see. It is very beautiful, not just in its sculptures, in the way it is proportionate, in its symmetry and everything, but it is also sculpted very beautifully, both exterior and interior. Rajarani temple. This magnificent temple is believed to be built in the 11th century CE and was earlier known as the Indreshwara temple. It has Ashtadikpalas and a lot of Apsara carvings adorning its exteriors. The sculptures are as same as they would be on any other temple, but why they are different is the depth of their expressions. The most notable is the image of Varuna, that is intact and notable for its ornamentation, coiffure and facial expression. Other sculptures include tall, slender, sophisticated apsaras, and not just the apsaras are standing there in their various roles, but they are also showing various moods. That is fondling a child, holding the branch of a tree, looking into the mirror, taking off her anklet, caressing a pet bird, playing a musical instrument. So you can find them in different moods. Rajarani temple is a Pancharatha style of temple with a vimana and a bada over its roof, rising to a height of 18 meters. The Jagmohan with a pyramidal roof. The vimana is surrounded by a cluster of miniature towers with double crowning elements and appears much like the towers of the Khajuraho temples. The temple is classified as a Panchayatana temple, where apart from the main shrine, there are four subsidiary shrines in the four corners of the temple. On account of its later origin, Brahmeshwara temple is a perfectly developed structure when compared to the Mukteshwara temple. Here you will find all the elements, whether it is the Udayata Singhas or the Guda Chakkadas, all developed in its finality. It has a wealth of sculptures, and iron beams were first used in this temple. As I said, you won't find pillars. So this is the first temple in the entire country to have iron beams used first. The Lingaraj temple, the most very beautiful temple dedicated to Harihara, a form of Shiva and Vishnu, and it was built around 11th century CE when the cult of Jagannath was establishing itself. It is the largest temple in Bhuvaneshwar and one of the wonders of medieval architecture in India. It represents the quintessence of the Kalinga school of temple architecture and has a distinct Rekha Deol, Pita Deol, Natya Mandap, Bhoga Mandap. The temple complex has 50 other shrines and is enclosed by a large compound wall. The Jagannath temple in Puri is one of the highest achievements of this school of temple architecture. The huge temple complex covers an area of 37,000 square meters and is surrounded by a high fortified wall. Within it lies 120 temples and shrines. The temple has four distinct sectional structures, namely Vimana in Rekha Deol style, Mukhashala, Frontal Porch, Nat Mandap and Bhog Mandap. The temple tower is built on a raised platform that was seen in the later phases. Now this raised platform is as high as 65 meters above the inner sanctum where the deities reside, dominates the surrounding landscape. The pyramidal roofs of the surrounding temples and adjoining halls or mandapas rise in step towards the tower like a ridge of mountain peaks. The Sun Temple in Konark. Among all the Kalinga temples, the one that stands unparalleled in terms of both architectural conception and sculptural brilliance is the Great Sun Temple at Konark. At present, only the Jagmohan remains, his soaring Vimana lost long ago. The sheer size of the perfectly proportionate structure is matched by the endless wealth of decoration on its body, from minute patterns in bas-relief executed with jeweler's precision to boldly modeled freestanding sculptures. The temple was conceived as a huge chariot, with the halls as the main body of the chariot. It has 12 wheels representing the 12 months. So it is a monument of epic imagination, the realization of creative upsurge of Kalinga architects. who continuously built temples for 7 centuries. The main temple, the whole edifice seems to symbolize the sun god emerging from the depth of the blue expanse. There is also a subsidiary shrine dedicated to Aruna, his charioteer. The lavishly ornamented wheels of the divine chariot are carved against the sides of the high platform and also on the two sides of the east staircase immediately in front of the main entrance to the form. It is the height of the Jagmohan is 39 meters. The Vimana, which was supposedly 70 meters tall, existed up to 1837. And among the structures which have survived to the current day are the Natya Mandap and the Pog Mandap. The current temple is attributed to Narasimha Deva of the Eastern Ganga dynasty. The temple may have been a monument built to his victory against Tughral Tughan Khan. In 1984, UNESCO bestowed it with the honor of being a World Heritage Site. You can see huge elephants here. The Gajasimha Vidala took a different form in Konark Temple. With the decline of the Eastern Ganga dynasty also came the decline of the Kalinga school of temple architecture. The Suryavanshi Gajapatis were more focused towards the culture and literature rather than grand constructions. The coming of Adi Shankara and establishing his Srividya cult and the prominent rising of the Jagannath cult being one of the reasons. There is another reason also for the decline in this phase, which was in the form of the iconoclast called Kala Pahad. It has an interesting story. I would not go into too much details. I will tell you in short that Kala Pahad was supposed to be a Hindu Brahmin who fell in love with a Muslim girl. She was a Muslim princess actually, and he decided to convert himself to Islam in order to marry her. But down the line he realized that he cannot live the life of a Muslim, so he came back to Odisha and decided to reconvert himself. But the Brahmins in Odisha, mainly the Konark temple, told him that reconversion was not a part of Hindu scriptures. In fact, conversion was not a part of Hindu scriptures. He went back broken-hearted, and he was so angry that he turned into an iconoclast. He destroyed temples with a vengeance, and many of this Kalingan order temples have been destroyed by him. We really do not know why he left the temples of Bhuvaneshwar intact, the Ekamra Kshetra then intact, but others were all destroyed by him in anger. He was known as the Kala Pahad. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. There is much more to learn and much more to know, for which you can visit the e-text that is present on the website, and you can also go about finding things by yourself for more details. Thank you very much.